She claimed the old boy visited her every night for a month. Just stood by her bed in his priest robe and stared down at her imploringly. One night she decided to overcome her fear and try and communicate with him. I don't think she was too successful, but I think they eventually communicated with a bit of Latin and a few prayers. Anyway, the upshot was this old priest was telling her that he was walled up at the end of her room behind the wardrobe and his spirit wanted out.
Anything wrong, Hauptmann?
Just looking, Mr. Darnie.
If it's women you're looking for, we'll all get up and help you.
Good night, gentlemen.
Good night. Well, come on, Paddy, what happened?
Well, it was all a bit odd. Great Aunt Maud said she was so bothered by the old monk's attitude, she had the local builder in to bash a hole in the wall. Damn me if she didn't find a flaming great priest's hole behind the plaster and a decomposed corpse, hundreds of years old, sitting there. She always claimed she recognized what was left of the face as the old lad who came a-haunting. He never came again.
You tell a good story, Paddy. Good night.
Well, Dick's point was that once they were out, they stood a better chance of getting clear if we could delay the Germans finding out that anyone had escaped. Well, I think I know how to do it. Now, it's based on the fact that at Appell, the Germans don't check names and faces. They only count heads. Now, we find or we make a hole somewhere in the castle and we hide two blokes in it. When Appell's call, there are two missing. Apparently, two prisoners have escaped. Now, the Germans go out of their minds trying to find two men who haven't gone. Now, later, when all the fuss has died down, we send two men out on a genuine escape. The two blokes hiding in the hole come out and take their place at Appell. That way, the head count remains the same. There's nobody missing. And that gives the chaps who are out on the genuine escape as much time as they want to get clear. As long as the hole isn't discovered, we can go on doing it as long as we want.
Well, it sounds like a pretty good idea. There's a awful lot of ifs in it, though. Well, that hole would have to be pretty good. They may have to be down there for some time. And you'd have to be able to feed them and let them out occasionally for exercise. Perhaps it would be better if it wasn't always the same two men.
Well, I haven't worked all that out yet, sir.
Well, couldn't you work some sort of rota system amongst volunteers?
Yeah, that's a possibility.
Well, leaving that aside for a moment, what about this hole? You got any ideas?
Well, yes, sir. I've just come from the chapel. Now, the Germans don't go in there very often. They don't search there a lot. But we can go in there quite regularly. We can go in and out as we please. Now, there's a perfect place right under the pulpit. And the pulpit's movable. I'm pretty sure two chaps could shift it.
All right, Simon, it's a good idea. Let's give it a go.
Right, thank you, sir. Oh, as it's the chapel, do you think we should include the Padres in our scheme?
No. Not for the moment.
Quelle heure est-il? What time is it? Let us begin with midnight, the beginning of any new day. Minuit. Minuit. Midnight. Minuit. And now let us look at the word for midday or noon. Now we understand that we subtract the number of minutes after the half hour from the next hour, using the word moins, which of course means less.
Moins. Okay.
Voilà.
10 heures, moins 2.
Ah, Monsieur Carter, merci. Très bien. Et votre cheville, comment ça va? Your ankle, how is it?
Oh, it's on the mend, thanks.
So, we have 10 heures, moins 12.
10 heures, moins 12.
Carry on, Oliver. All right, gentlemen, sit yourselves down where you can find the room, do you? All right, Oliver?
Yes, sir. Fine.
Now, you've all had time to consider this scheme. I want to hear your views on it. As you know, Simon has already had the hole prepared in the chapel.
Yeah, we're all ready to go once we have the volunteers.
Fine. Well, I have just one more thing to say. And that is that no one should lose sight of the effort, the patience, and the courage he's going to need to be buried for considerable lengths of time. It's no small matter. Anybody who thinks it is wrong. It could be down there for weeks. Now, the consolation is that Simon thinks that they can be fed very regularly and let out occasionally for exercise. That's all I've got to say. Over to you.
Right. Well, we do it with two initially. If we can find suitable hiding places, we may increase the number later on, but for the moment, it's two. Now, Colonel Preston has suggested that whoever volunteers automatically goes to the top of the escape list.
What about the other schemes we have going?
Well, they're only affected if this ghost operation can be of any use to that particular escape.
Well, I think it's a damn good idea.
Great.
Well, I think you're mad. I mean, who the hell is going to be entombed for weeks on end in some bloody hole? Half-starved, frozen stiff, and dying for a pee. I mean, have you any idea what you're asking, Sam?
Yes, I have, and I think it's a damn good scheme.
Well, right. Jerry Tumble. I mean, people are recognizable.
Jerry only counts heads, and you know it. Look, what's the matter with you chaps? This is one of the best ideas we've ever had.
All right, it's a good idea, but we're also risking bringing Jerry right down on our necks without actually getting anyone away.
Well, I think it's worth it.
Well, I don't. You can count me out for a start.
How long would anyone have to live down there? Seriously.
Well, the Colonel said it could be weeks.
I'd like to have a try.
You sure?
I'll be the other one, if that's right.
All right. Well, if it's all right with you, sir, they're elected. As from tomorrow, you two don't live here anymore. You're going to give me a hand with the pulpit?
Yes, of course. But I still think it's
a hell of a risk, right?
Yes.
well use the time tunneling. We can't just sit here.
Not while Ullman's playing with his toys. I don't know how good they are yet. Can you find the lamp?
I see someone.
Alles in Ordnung, Herr Hauptmann. Zwei fehlen.
Zwei Men fällen, Herr Hauptmann.
Haben Sie in den Quartieren nachgeschaut?
Nein, Herr Hauptmann.
Dann mal los.
Jawohl. Sehen Sie in den englischen Quartieren nach.
Two of your men are missing, Colonel Preston.
Really?
Ils ont déjà parti.
There is no other possible explanation, sir.
Major, I cannot permit you openly criticizing my officers. They are carrying out my own orders. Can only imply that you are criticizing your commanding officer. You are new to this game, Major. I understand your concern and your zeal. But we are not part of a cat and mouse game. We do everything in our power to retain and secure enemy personnel whose avowed intent is to escape. The record of Coldis Castle speaks for itself.
With respect, sir, I was appointed here after four officers had escaped together.
Quite so. That is why I'm taking advantage of your presence here. Major, I am appointing you area controller, directly responsible for the recovery of prisoners once they have breached our walls. You will, of course, work from your office here in the castle and coordinate Wehrmacht, police, and Landwacht activity. Is that understood?
Perfectly, sir.
Your points about the security equipment are very valid. Would these meet your requirements, Major?
Excellently, sir.
Hauptmann Ullmann indented for that equipment 14 months ago with my full approval. As you can see from the last notification, little of it is available to us, and then only in due course, whenever that may be.
But this equipment is vital to security, sir.
And to our armed forces. It is also in short supply, thanks to Allied bombing. Come in.
We have completed a most thorough search of the entire castle, sir. I have to report that there is not the slightest trace or indication of how the escape was effected.
Do you have any theories?
None, sir. To formulate a theory, we need one small clue. There is nothing.
Especially security. Allied prisoners are escaping all the time, and not just from this camp, whereas German officers do not seem to escape from Allied hands. Why is that, Ullmann?
One may be forced to conclude that German officers do not wish to escape, Herr Major.
We have installed what equipment has been sent to us, and we will do our duty to the best of our ability. The better for not arguing amongst ourselves, gentlemen. Major Mohn, since the prisoners seem to have left the castle, their recovery is now in your hands. You have my permission to carry on. Hauptmann Ullmann, One moment, please. This is a very serious situation. If the Wehrmacht are to remain in control here in Colditz, every effort must be made to tighten security. That is your responsibility. Please see to it.
Yes, sir.
Thought it was just me. It's right into your bones. I think there was something we could do. If that bell was on time, we'd be here 12, 13 hours.
Seems like a week.
Yeah. Well, at least we seem to have got away with it. Football in the yard.
No, it's too early for football.
All right. It's been cold.
God, I'm stiff.
Listen, it worked beautifully, but there's a change of plan. There's no time for a stretch now. Ullman's tearing the place apart.
It's really hounding us.
Listen, we brought what we could. It's not much, but it'll have to do until we can get back. It'll be about 24 hours.
Ready?
Simon, we need a blanket. Right.
We got a couple of potatoes. Small bag of sugar. Water. Coffee.
Simon's becoming a sadist.
George, I'll tell you what it is. So as
those other fellas. Paddy's boys. Priests from the hole. The ghosts. Here, have a spud.
Raus mit euch, aber schnell!
Das sind Franzosen.
Das sind Franzosen.
I'm sorry, Lieutenant. It's out of my hands.
The chapel is a place of worship. I can't understand.
If prisoners want to abuse their privileges, they cannot complain if those privileges are taken away from them.
But
I'm sorry. If you wish to continue your services, I suggest you hold them in the courtyard.
It is hardly suitable.
Lieutenant, I do not personally subscribe to your faith, but if I did, I would accept your own axiom. God's house is everywhere. Good night.
I mean, the fact remains that two of our chaps are stuck down that hole without the remotest possible chance of getting out under their own steam. What's the food and water situation?
Well, we managed to get some rations to them so they can hold out for a while.
Well, that's not good enough, is it?
Are you suggesting that we give this scheme up, sir, at the first hint of trouble? Listen, they're all right for a little while. Let me see if I can find another way around it.
Come in. Oh, hello, Doc. Thank you for coming. Well, you know the trouble we're in, I suppose. How long can they last out down there?
Well, in their present state, I estimate 3 days. Top
three?
Weight.
They're good for five.
Damn it, Simon, I do know something about my job.
They're used to short rations?
Possibly, but I'm not talking about starvation or dying of thirst. Have you any idea what the temperature's like? On an earth floor, under stone, in a damp and semi-airless hole? It is serious.
Yes, I'm quite aware of that. All right, Simon, I give you and the committee until tomorrow morning to work out some scheme to get to those two. If you can't, I must... Come in. Oh, Andre, hello. Excuse me a moment. That'll be all.
Sir. Look here, Simon, I don't give a damn what schemes you've got going. Just you get those chaps out of there, or I'll use my medical prerogative and override the colonel.
They'll be all right.
He will not be all right. They're going to run out of food and water. The air will become putrid, their body temperatures have dropped to danger level, and their resistance as low as it is, they'll contract pneumonia in no time at all.
They know what they're doing.
Look, what happens if one of them dies?
I'll take that responsibility.
You haven't a right. It's my job to keep those men alive.
And it's my job to get them out.
You know, Andre, I think we both owe each other an apology.
À la vôtre.
I'm referring, of course, to your tunnel in the chapel. I'm sorry it was discovered. We all are. But the fact remains that our escape officer wasn't informed about it. And that could have endangered other escape attempts.
Had I been informed of any escape attempts likely to endanger ours, I would have mentioned it, John.
Well, that's what I mean about owing each other an apology.
You have an escape planned for the chapel? I am sorry.
Well, let's stick to the rules in future, shall we, Andre? Just keep each other informed.
Yeah.
Considerable undertaking, sir.
I am aware of its scope, Major. Is there some point you wish to make?
Yes, Herr Oberst. Hauptmann Ullmann, if you would be kind enough to read this report, please, and the inventory. Read it aloud, please, Ullmann.
The French tunnel is 44 meters in length. It proceeds from the cellar under the floor of the chapel, eventually dropping down some 8.5 meters and out under the castle walls. It was already through the stone and into the soft outside earth when discovered. In the process of the tunneling, I have calculated that the prisoners have removed over 3 tons of earth and stone, which they have hidden about the castle.
3 tons, sir. The inventory, please, Ulrich.
140 meters of shoring timber, 36 meters of timber rails for 2 trolleys with wheels, 94 meters of rope, 162 meters of electric cable, 19 electric light bulbs and holders, 1 fuse switchboard, 38 sandbags, 4 shovels, 4 hammers, 2 picks, 1 crowbar, 3 metal pulleys, 6 empty wine bottles derived from our own cellars, and 1 Brabant sausage.
Please make your point, Major.
It is one thing to discover a tunnel, sir. We should also recognize that this work has been going on for over a year, during which time 3 tons of material have been disposed of without our knowledge, to say nothing of the material which has been stolen. How can this be, Ullmann?
We have to deal with...
I am grateful for your report, Major. But there are 2 prisoners still missing. Have you had news of them?
I regret, sir. Neither the police nor the Gestapo have been able to find any trace of the missing prisoners. They have vanished into thin air, sir.
Indeed. Thank you, Major. Gentlemen. And you're quite sure it can't be done?
Yes, sir. We've been through every possibility. There's no other way. Only the sacristy leads off the chapel, and that doesn't have a door. It doesn't even have a window.
Right. Well, it's about time the padre made representations to the commandant to get that chapel opened again. Ask him to come and see me, will you?
Yes,
sir. Simon, on second thoughts, don't you ask him. Get the officer of the day to do.
Right, sir.
How long can we hold out? I mean, suppose no one comes.
We better see what we can do on our own. Put your back against the stone. No, no. Use your feet. I'll try with my back. Right. Right.
Oh, hello, Padre. How are you?
Oh, all right, thank you, sir.
Good, good. Come and sit down, won't you?
Thank you.
Padre, I've had several representations to get the chapel open for worship again. That's what I wanted to see you about. Have you made any approaches to the Commandant about it?
No, sir. I did speak to Father Denny and Pastor Vesuvius, of course, and we decided it was a military matter. Well, the chapel has been used unlawfully.
Yes, of course.
I did approach Ullman, but he suggested that service could be held in the courtyard. He reminded me that God's house is everywhere. He's right, of course. So I've just put up a notice for service for this afternoon.
Right, for outside?
Yes.
It's going to be a bit cold out there, Padre, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah, you know, I really think we ought to make some approach to the Commandant.
Well, as you wish, sir, but in the meantime, I intend to hold a church parade outside today. Or perhaps by next Sunday, we will have persuaded the Commandant to reopen the chapel.
Yes, perhaps. You know, Padre, I think a lot of the officers would like to show that they're behind you in this. I mean, perhaps if we had a really good turnout today, it might make the Germans think again.
Yes, well, in all honesty, I can't pretend that I attract a multitude.
No, perhaps not. But, you know, I think on this occasion I might be able to guarantee you one. What time is your service?
2 o'clock, sir.
2. Well, if you could put it back and I say till 3, I think I could make sure to have quite a good turnout.
I don't see why not. Do you think you could possibly get the word around?
Yes, just leave that to me. I'm pretty sure I can.
Good. We'll show those Jerrys. Well, thank you. This is most gratifying. Do you know, I didn't think anyone really cared.
Right. I want volunteers for a church parade at 1500 hours, and that means everybody.
Oh, no.
SBO's orders. Simon. Where's Paddy Moore?
Let us pray. Almighty God, bringer of all good things, look down upon thy servants in adversity. Help us to bear the trials and tribulations of human frailty. Give us light. Take from us the doubts and uncertainties that question thy eternal wisdom. Grant us, we beseech thee, the comfort of thy Holy Spirit through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
How's it going?
It's all ready. Couldn't get at them all, but it's enough to channel most of the power into the courtyard speakers. Should be quite effective, I think.
And I said to the man who stood at the gate of the year, give me some light, that I may enter safely into the unknown. My friends, you and I find ourselves today standing in this cold yard, confined in an ancient castle in the middle of Germany, among, in the words of our last hymn, unnumbered foes. We are held captive, away from home, and our loved ones. Thank you. It is rather cold, I'm afraid. We have been forbidden the use of our place of worship. And yet I tell you, God sees us. He knows our plight and is not unmindful. And yet our German captors attend their churches and make worship. And doubtless God hears their plea too. We ask ourselves a recurring question.
Hier ist der Reichssender Berlin. How can this... Nachrichten. Zuerst der Herrliche.
Your service was a shambles. I'm ashamed. It was an affront to God. It is essential that an approach be made to the Commandant to reopen the chapel immediately.
All right, Padre, I'll go and see him at once. Do I take it I shall be making this representation on behalf of all denominations?
In my anger, I came straight to you, but I feel certain we would not be presuming upon anyone's finer feelings if the request were made for all.
All right. Padre, I think I would prefer that you came with me.
Simon. Okay, what are you doing about Player and Brent?
Not now, Doc.
Simon, your time's up. Their food ran out ages ago. Their physical condition must have deteriorated
alarmingly. For God's sake, it's bad enough with Ullman and his flaming machine all over the place without you getting at me as if I'm trying to kill somebody. I'm not a sadistic sod, you know. I don't enjoy this. The Colonel's with the Commandant now. They're trying to have the chapel reopened. We haven't reached your deadline yet.
Simon, it was 2 days ago.
I don't think I quite understand you, Major.
I think you do, Colonel Preston. The Commandant is not available at this moment. I am deputed to listen to all complaints and act as I see fit.
May I remind you that as senior British officer, I am entitled to see the commanding officer of this prison camp on any matter relevant to the welfare of the men under my command. Once request has been made, I am making that request. I cannot accept that a junior officer ranking below me should intercede or deny...
As a prisoner of war, I hardly think it is a matter of your acceptance.
And I must insist that my request be made known to the Commandant immediately.
Request refused.
No, I'm afraid not. I've been refused access to the Commandant. Simon, at the next appel, I want you to tell the officer of the day to give no orders, because you'll receive none from me. As of this moment, I refuse to command the British contingent at Colditz.
Hey! Master!
Now, come on, Padre, that's quite impossible.
I assure you, I must have sunk one of your battleships.
Well, let's check the numbers again, shall we? D2. Mm-hmm. F4.
Lieutenant Carter, what is happening?
I don't know.
Why are the British officers not on parade?
We don't have any orders.
What is the trouble, Hartmann?
The British prisoners are refusing to parade. Apparently there is no chain of command.
Indeed. Do I see a senior officer?
He's in his quarters.
Take two men and bring him down here.
Lieutenant Carter.
Sir.
Is Colonel Preston ill?
No, sir.
Hartmann, go to Colonel Preston's quarters and remind him that Appel has been called. Inform him that the commandant is inspecting the parade and demands that he present himself forthwith.
Sir.
I'd like an explanation of this conduct, Colonel.
Commandant, earlier today, I made a request of your second in command to see you with my chaplain. That request was refused. As senior British officer, I have the right of reasonable request to you about the welfare of my men. If that access is denied, my authority therefore undermined. I have no alternative but to relinquish that authority and cease to command the British officers in Colditz.
I see. Colonel Preston, there has obviously been a misunderstanding of my orders. If you will reassume command of your officers for Appel, I will see you in my office immediately after.
Thank you, Commandant.
Captain Downing, please.
Sir.
Falling the officers.
Sir.
British contingent, fall in.
Commandant, I quite understand your reasons for closing the chapel. It is my belief that it is every man's right to worship as he sees fit. That means in his own way and in a place set aside for that purpose.
Lieutenant Jordan, is it not possible to conduct services in the courtyard?
I've held one today, sir. It was a disaster. Apart from the obvious distractions and noise, several men fainted with the cold. They are already very weak, you must realize.
Very well, the chapel may be opened for worship once again, but it will continue to be locked after curfew. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, Mayor.
Colonel Preston, I think you might have had the courtesy to inform me of your true intention regarding the chapel. God and divine worship is not just another attribute to be employed to the advantage of the escape committee. For myself, I don't particularly mind being used. I may be nothing more than a padre, but I am also a man. I have my loyalties and duties, which are not strictly those of my calling. Couldn't you have trusted me as a fellow officer?
I apologize. There was no intention to make light of the solemnity of worship, and I don't think we've done so, but I could not include you in our plans.
I accepted the responsibilities of a soldier when I put on this uniform. My cloth is khaki, Colonel. I'm not ashamed to be wearing it. Too many men-at-arms regard us as children to be tolerated in the halls of men. When I was a child, I spoke as a child. I understood as a child, I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things.
Nevertheless, Padre, your calling does effectively place you outside certain activities. I cannot, in fact, I will not place you in an untenable position. Your cloth demands that difference in that respect. Now, to worship as we see fit is, I submit, one of the reasons that we're fighting and escaping for. If I have offended you as a man, it is because of your cloth. I very much doubt, Padre, if you can have it both ways.
All right, you can put your shirt on. Well?
No,
they're lucky this time. No real damage done.
Right, we can go on with it.
What do you mean, go on with it?
Well, as two have escaped, they can hardly appear again, can they? Not without giving the whole game away. Well, can they?
You're not saying you expect them to go back into that damned hole?
Well, not immediately, no. I've worked out a rota of volunteers. These two will take their turn on it like everybody else. Oh, come off it, Doc.
Who's going next?
Willoughby and Naylor. I've already got another hole.
You never stop, do you?
That's what it's all about, mate.